So what we have here is a piece of paper that if you have a Canson Mitian's paper, you will have two sides to it. One side will be smooth and the other side will have a toothy quality. And so when you draw on the toothy quality or the grainy side or the rough side, you'll be able to see a very specific grain. Okay? And one way of finding out is to feel with your hands to see which side is smoother, which side is rougher. Or you can put down a mark or two, and you should be able to tell whether it's the smooth side or the rough side. Okay, so you have two pencils here. You have the charcoal white, and it doesn't have any grade on it. It just says General's Charcoal White. Okay, and then you have General's Charcoal HB Hard, which is the black pencil. And General's Charcoal comes in different grades. So you have like 4B, 6B, and so on and so forth. And you want to make sure you get the HB, the hard pencil. And the hard pencil is good because you can build up your values. And if you used it to build up your values, you'll get a nice, rich, sort of deep, dark. Okay? You could potentially do that with your hard pencil. If you use a very soft pencil, you get dark very, very quickly. And sure, you'll be able to get the value dark very quickly, but then it's more of a flat value, as opposed to using a hard pencil and building it up to the value that you want. Okay. Now we have three different erasers, or four. Okay, four different erasers. This is your pink pearl eraser, which is obviously pink and heavy duty. And what does that mean? That means that if you have a mark in there and you really want to remove it, then this, to me, I would call it the industrial strength eraser, because you could really remove the mark very easily. But then it also slightly messes up the paper, so you want to use this as a last resort. Okay, then this one is your white, soft white eraser, which is nice. So this one will be able to remove whatever marks that you want to remove easily, and you don't need to resort to this. Unless it's some stubborn marks on there, then you could try your pink pearl eraser. Okay, then you have your needle eraser. What's nice about the needle eraser is that you could use the needle eraser until it's like really, really dirty. What you do is that you basically, if you have a new set of needle eraser, you tear off a chunk. And this one's not new, so it's a little bit dark, but a little dirty. But if you have a new one, it's a lighter gray, and you just peel off a small blob and leave the rest so that it's always clean, and you'll always have fresh needle eraser. And you take this and you can pull out the value by just pressing down on it and then lifting and then kneading it and doing that again. So what's nice is that you don't have to sort of erase this way, but you can actually lift the value or the marks off the paper by just dabbing with it. And then make sure you knead it so that you have like a clean surface and you can continue doing that. Some students will take the needle eraser and they keep doing this and keep dabbing and removing the marks, which is fine. But the problem is that then you have some values on the needle erasers, and when you erase, as you lift off some of the marks, you're also depositing some of it back. So sometimes you get this smudge quality. So you don't want that. Make sure you just keep kneading it, okay? And if you want to erase it, you could just erase it like a regular eraser, okay? And then you have this cylindrical eraser, and you can actually get from some stores where it's finer. This one's kind of thick. The diameter is kind of thick. But you can get a finer one, and this is great because you could go in and sort of pick at something and get like details. So the cylindrical eraser, you know, you can hold it in your hand like a pencil or a pen, and it works really nicely, especially if you want to get little highlights out or you want to get little light areas out, and you get fine details with this eraser, the cylindrical eraser. And again, you can buy much smaller cylindrical erasers which are finer or smaller diameter eraser in them. Okay, all right, so that's all the materials right now. And so what we're going to do is that we're going to use these materials to create different types of mark making. So what we'll start off with is something called hatch marks. Hatch marks means that marks that fall in parallel to one another. Okay, so if you're drawing this way, you're creating hatch marks. And anytime any two lines cross one another, they become cross hatching.
Okay? Now, how important is a sharpened pencil to cross hatching?
It's really important because you want to make sure that your pencil maintains a fine point. So then, if you draw with a fine pencil, the marks that you make will be fine, and it will be sophisticated. If you draw with a dull pencil, you will have more contact point with the paper. So with a fine point, you have very minimal contact point with the paper, whereas with a dull edge, you will have a larger contact point with the paper, therefore you make a bigger mark. And then as a result, you also have, you know, it doesn't work as well with controlling a range of values. So with a fine point, you make a nice, sophisticated mark, and you can control your values better as well, okay? So remember, cross-hatching is when any two lines cross, and they can go in any direction. And you don't have to cross-hatch vertically and horizontally. That just feels very unnatural. To me, it feels very unnatural. Like it's forced. Crosshatch in a way that feels comfortable to you. Diagonals to me work really nicely. Or just keep moving and keep moving your hand and changing direction when you crosshatch.
Now, right?
This feels very unnatural.
How would you use a crosshatch to help inform the shape of an object?
Okay, so if you are drawing sort of a spherical object like a ball, okay? You can cross-hatch by first laying down the hatch marks that are curved. So the reason why I'm doing this is because I'm trying to describe the roundedness of the plane of the object itself. So if it's a sphere, like a ball, then it's rounded. So I'm using these hatch marks and they're curved to describe that roundedness of form. Then you can layer another layer of hatch marks so they become cross-hatching because now the two marks are intersecting, okay? And that will continue to describe the roundedness of that the ball or the sphere. Now, you could do that, obviously. And I find that with an inanimate object like, say, a sphere or a ball, you know, in a still life, I would just cross-hatch at a diagonal. And that may seem like, you know, it doesn't make sense, but it does, because ultimately if you lay down your values correctly and you have enough range of values, you'll be able to get the sphere to be spherical. You'll be able to get it to be volumetric, okay? When you cross-hatch and you curve your lines to sort of emphasize or accentuate the curvature of the plane of the object, sure, you'll be able to get that roundedness of form, but I feel that it has this organic look. So I would oftentimes reserve that for, say, if you're drawing a branch, you know, because a branch has a cylindrical shape. So if you're drawing a branch, then I think it works quite nicely. So let's just pretend there's a branch right here, you know. So it has that, it lends to or gives it that organic quality because it's an organic form. So for, say if I'm drawing a branch, you know, sure, I'll cross-hatch this way, but then if I'm drawing, say, a sphere, I can just cross-hatch in a diagonal. And it will create a three-dimensional quality when you get all your values down correctly. Okay, so cross-hatching is it's a nice way to create texture. And when you cross-hatch, just make sure that you continue moving so that you don't get too dark at any one point. Okay? So this is very different than this. This is really, this is not cross-hatching. This is like more like just scribbling, okay? When you cross-hatch, you literally lift your pencil and there are parallel strokes, okay? So notice also that you can hold your pencil in a way that's comfortable for you. I like to hold my pencil this way and draw, because what it does is that I can draw very, very lightly. You can hardly even see the marks on the paper. And it feels very gestural because I'm utilizing my arm, okay? When you draw this way, which one normally does, the movement is very much restricted to the wrist. You have more control, but the lines are a little bit darker than when you hold your pencil this way, okay? So this way, sometimes students feel very uncomfortable because it feels unnatural, but to me, you exert some form of control over your drawing implement, your pencil, by placing the base of your pencil in the middle of your palm so that you, it's sort of like anchored there, and you wrap your sort of your thumb and your index finger and you hold that pencil so that you do have some form of control, okay? But of course, not as much control as this. But ultimately, when you draw, you should hold the pencil in whichever way that you feel comfortable, okay? All right, the other way of creating values or creating marks would be the smooth overlaying of marks. And that would mean just moving your pencil in a consistent manner. Just keep moving it. Sometimes students shade this way and then they get really puzzled and they don't understand why it's sort of patchy. Some areas are dark, some areas are lighter, and it doesn't seem like there's a nice transition or gradation of value. And that is because oftentimes students get so caught up in trying to make sure it's smooth that they maybe stay too long in one spot, like what I'm doing now. And of course, then it becomes too dark and it feels abrupt. So just continue moving. And you'll be able to get that nice gradation. Don't put pressure. There's no need to put pressure on your pencil. Sure, you can get it really dark by putting pressure, but it's not the same as opposed to like building your values with light layers. Many, many light layers will create a nice range of values as opposed to like with pressure, okay? The other way of creating this would be to shade in a circular fashion or move in a circular fashion, like what I'm doing. Some students like to do this, and it does give you a nice sort of gradation of values. You could create that. It's pretty consistent, but to me, this seems kind of painful, so it's uncomfortable. Feels a little unnatural, so I don't shade that way. But again, like I said, whichever way that feels comfortable for you and works for you, that should be the way that you approach your drawing. And same goes with your white pencil. You do the same thing that I've just shown you with the black pencil.